Welcome to the Physics and Astronomy Colloquium. I have a tremendous pleasure today to introduce Dr. Matt Eichenfield, our speaker from San Diego National Labs. Matt has been has had a pretty distinguished career already, although looking at him, you wouldn't think of him like that. Anyway, he came from the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. That's where he did his bachelor's work. He was one of the most distinguished alums, I guess. And in fact, he was the top graduating senior in the year that he graduated from the of the 4,000 that graduated that year. Then he went on to Caltech, where he did much of the work that sort of laid the foundation for what you hear today. And at Caltech, he had a number of awards as well, culminating in this best dissertation prize for the field of nanosciences under the Mitiadris Prize. And then he continued there for another couple of years as a postdoctoral fellow, which is another, is a Copley Institute for Nanoscience Prize Fellowship, postdoctoral fellowship that goes on. And then he came to San Diego Labs a couple of years ago, I guess in 2011, and he has been actually the Harry Truman Fellow, who's a postdoctoral fellow for National Security Science and Technology Fellow. So anyway, he's going to probably illuminate a little bit of that today as well, the science fellowship. But he will tell us about the experimental and theoretical studies of the physics of these coupled systems of phonons, photons, and electrons, actually. And this is the whole business of quantum mechanical crystals at a nanoscale. And these are engineered systems. And you will, of course, hear the story much better than I could ever tell. So here's my comments.
I know that Sudhakar has a photographic memory because I'm not sure if I just have my own CD quite that well from memory. Also, sitting in the audience kind of gives you some different perspective on your talk. I just sat there looking at that poor nanusical for about 5 minutes. So, I think it goes a long way. Okay, well, anyway, so thanks for having me here today. Appreciate the opportunity to give the talk. And I'm going to be telling you today, like Sudhakar said, about some experiments that I did both for my PhD and my postdoc, and then of course the things that I'm trying to get to these days. And this picture here is obviously a fairly complicated looking panorama, but there's a lot going on, and there's also just sort of very little going on. And the goal of the talk will be in part to get you to understand what all of this stuff is. And so we'll start out from sort of a schematic point of view and just tell you what you're looking at. We'll get there, I promise. this is single crystal silicon, okay, which is what's making up this material here. This material is single crystal silicon, okay. And underneath you right here, you can actually see there's another material that's glass, and then there's an air gap between the silicon and the glass. And so this is a floating membrane made of single crystal silicon. And this is all on the surface of a microchip. So the same kind of microchip that you might have in your Intel processor has been used to make this structure with very similar kinds of techniques. And of course, the size scale is illustrated here. So of course, the diameter of a human hair is about 100,000 nanometers, which would be about 5 of these lengths here. So, quite larger than the room if it had been in the SEM at the time that this picture were taken. And the largest feature is really sort of the length of the beam here, which is about 20,000 nanometers, 20 microns. And the smallest are these little connectors down here in this sort of lattice, which are down to 100 nanometers. And of course, the most important thing in this picture is this bridge structure here. And that's about around a half a micron thick, and 200 nanometers thick, about 0.2 microns thick, and about half a micron wide. And then there are these little railroad track looking things, which I'll explain, which are around 200 nanometers. So most of the features are something around 1,000 times smaller than the diameter of human hair, of order 100 to 1,000 sort of atomic diameters, or lattice spacing, than even atomic diameters. But. And the whole goal of this, making this structure, actually is to be able to trap optical photons and microwave frequency phonons in the very, very center of this beam. So all of this other support structure is really just there to sort of serve higher order confinement purposes, making the losses smaller and all that. But really, all the action really happens right here in the center, sort of five rungs of this beam, where we trap these microwave frequency, acoustic vibrations, and optical frequency, electromagnetic vibrations in the center of this. And the volume that we're trapping these particles in, these photons and phonons, is about 10,000 times smaller than the smallest human cell. And it turns out that the interaction between light and matter actually scales inversely with the volume. And so at this size scale, it turns out that every photon in this system can exert a force on the structure that's about 15 times the weight of the important part of the structure. So that at this size scale, with these kinds of interaction strengths, it's a very different world. It's a world where if you turn the light on, the light would crush you, smash you into the ground into a billion little bits. And the properties of materials can be dominated by the stiffness that's provided by light. So it's a very different world at this size scale and at these interaction strengths. Okay. So, of course, science is always done with some overarching motivation. We didn't just decide that we wanted to trap some photons and phonons. Actually, the motivation for this project is really driven by the pursuit of larger and larger quantum objects. So if you think about the world around you, if I tap the desk, there are some things about that, this process, that are quantum in nature, like the fact that my hand doesn't go through it. That's part of the Pauli exclusion principle, basically. But for the most part, the surrounding world around me doesn't behave quantum mechanically. I know that somehow underlying all these things, there's quantum mechanical interactions in quantum mechanical systems, but mostly what I observe can be described by classical mechanics. And so one of the overarching goals of modern physics is to sort of bridge the world between quantum systems and macroscopic systems, sort of classical systems. And so here's sort of a plethora of various systems that are, in fact, uniquely quantum mechanical. Here, these are trapped ions in an RF ion trap. This is a sort of a famous set of data from Bose-Einstein condensates showing the collapse of the momentum space wave function when reaching the ground state. This is a quantum dot, which is essentially a defect in a semiconductor type material that confines electrons to a very small volume. Superconductivity. This is a quantum Josephson junction, superfluid helium, and of course some experiments done at Caltech where they trap cold atoms inside of a cavity called cavity quantum electrodynamics. But there's not a lot of systems that are really sort of fundamentally quantum mechanical, even in the world of science. I mean, lasers are sort of underlie by quantum mechanical principles, but in the end, the physics can be described by rate equations, which are very, very classical. Okay, so if we want to have systems that are more akin to the macroscopic quantum objects that we see around us every day, then we need to sort of do some more engineering to figure out how we can find systems that are going to behave more and more quantum mechanically, even at larger and larger size scales. Okay, so why pursue quantum mechanics? Some of the reasons are just because of the very precision of science these days is sort of pushing down to the level that in order to test our theories more and more. With more and more scrutiny, we need to actually, push things in that direction. I mean, it's really at the quantum frontier that there may be deviation from what we think is true and what we can actually measure to be true. And so here are some figures of the very exacting kinds of measurements that have been done on, in quantum mechanical systems, like the land shift of the energy levels of hydrogen, which is known to a part, one part in 12 digits, et cetera. But the most important thing that people really know about quantum mechanics is it's kind of weird, right? And so it's, really the it if you, as a human being, you know, not as a scientist, because a scientist, I can write down wave functions and compute probabilities and probability curves, but as a human being, what I want to see is, you know, something teleport from there to there, you know, or something be in two places at once, or, you know, observe some kind of a Schrodinger cat state, right? So you know, we want to make this connection of the quantum world to be more sort of tangible. And of course, that really what that means is scaling up the objects, the things that I can see, I can touch. Okay, and so the objects that I'll talk about most of today, they're not, you know, I can't see them with my eye. They're sort of, they fit on the head of a pin. But on the other hand, they're small enough that, or they're large enough that I can see them with a microscope. And they're sort of they're of the form that if, you know, if I had enough beers and enough of my friends, I could probably go in the backyard and build something that looked just like them. And really be able to exacerbate the differences between the quantum world and the classical world. Okay, and so we wonder why we don't see these effects in big everyday things, and why there are these differences between the two environments, quantum and classical. But we also think that quantum theory should be valid for all objects. So as we scale them up, we want to learn a lot about how the transition between quantum to classical evolves. So, you know, why is this desk, which is mostly, you know, which is entirely made of what we think are quantum interactions, how does it become sort of a classical object in my world? Okay, and it turns out a good place to start is with mechanical harmonic oscillators, because they're simple, and in fact, the differences between quantum and classical harmonic oscillators is very stark. Okay, so this is a classical harmonic oscillator, which, you know, just as a very quick review, you know, mass on a spring with a spring constant K and mass M will generate a frequency, you know, omega, which is the square root of K over M. And, you know, the properties of this classical harmonic oscillator, they're fairly obvious. It oscillates harmonically around this equilibrium position, which I marked with this black line. And it can have an arbitrary energy, which includes zero, right? So the thing can have no energy at all. And any energy above that. All energies have the same basic shape. So this shape here, which describes the sort of quote-unquote probability of finding the particle at a position p, is always the same shape. So if I add more energy, the system just basically looks like a, you know, larger and larger version of this same underlying shape. And it's bounded, of course, by the energy turnaround points. If I know how much energy is in the system, I can tell you exactly how far it can deviate from the classical turnaround points. And it spends most of its time at the turnaround points, right? It's moving the slowest, it's not moving at all when it gets to the turnaround points, so it spends most of its time there, it spends the least amount of time at the equilibrium position. And it can be measured anywhere between those two points, right? There's no place where I find a zero probability of zero finding it somewhere. That wouldn't even make any sense sort of in the classical world. On the other hand, quantum harmonic oscillator is very different. Okay, so each value of the energy is described by a stationary wave function, no motion at all, right? They just sit there. They're phase evolves, but essentially they're not doing much except for that. The classical probability distribution for the energy of these quantum systems, so the same energy, this blue line, is underlined by this probability distribution here. So of course you can see that the classical turnaround point is here and here for the ground state of this quantum harmonic oscillator, but it extends very, very much further than the classical turnaround point. So, and in fact, it extends out to infinity just with vanishingly small probability, but they can be found well outside the classical turnaround points for a classical oscillator of the same energy. And of course, they can only have quantized excitations, so there's not n equals a half, there's just n equals zero and n equals one, n equals two, three, four, all integers. Like I said, they're not bounded by their classical turnaround points, and the probabilities don't look anything like their classical counterparts. In particular, if you look at the n equals one wave function, there's a place I can't measure it at all. Okay, so I can measure it here, and I can measure it here, but I can't measure it here, which is a very non-classical effect. Now, of course, the way that you get from the quantum world to the classical world is by adding energy, essentially. And so if you look at what happens as you add phonons to the system, as we go from n equals zero, where there's only one oscillation, essentially a half of an oscillation, as we go to, say, like n equals 10 or n equals 50, the rate of oscillation is increasing very rapidly. Okay, and the distribution, as you can see, is starting to look more and more like the underlying classical distribution. And so as I add energy to the system, it starts to, the overall envelope starts to look like the underlying classical probability, and the oscillation get faster and faster. And so if I think about what I would need to do to measure a quantum system, if you can imagine that to measure the ground state is very, very hard because I need some resolution in x that's about this big, then in order to measure n equals 50, it turns out I need a resolution that's square root 50 times better. And so as I go to higher and higher energies, I get to a place where I have to have even better experimental resolution in order to resolve quantum effects. So it's not that there's nothing quantum about the n equals 50 state, it's just that it's almost impossible to measure what is quantum if you can't measure the underlying ground state. Okay. And so, like I said, they have rapid oscillations with smaller and smaller wavelengths requiring higher resolution. They approach their corresponding classical distributions as you go to larger and larger n. They become increasingly bounded by the classical turnaround points. You can see that although the n equals 0 state extends well outside of its range, for the classical corresponding oscillator, n equals 50 kind of terminates right around here. So it's just got this little bit of tail outside of its classical turnaround point. So it's the correspondence principle is what this is called, and it basically means that the oscillator will start to look more and more classical as you go to higher and higher energies. Okay? And of course, this is what I was saying here, that the experimental uncertainty for measuring what we call the zero-point motion, which is the amplitude of the ground state, if that's what it takes to measure something quantum, then in order to measure a higher energy level state, you have to do even better, root n better. Okay. And of course, one big problem is that if I put the system in thermal equilibrium with some temperature bath, then all of the states get populated. And of course, as you know, when you populate multiple states, what you end up with is superposition, and the superposition oscillates between the various underlying excited states. And so it gets even more and more difficult to measure all these quantum effects if you don't just have a single state excited. And so really what you want to do is you want to bring this n bar close to zero so that you only have the ground state populated. That's the only one where it's going to sit still in one state. It's also the easiest to measure. Okay. And so what that does is it sets an experimental limit on the temperature that you need to cool this thing down to be able to measure the ground state. And so we, we'll call some equivalent ground state temperature, where you're less than h bar omega over 2 kV. And that's the temperature below which most of the population of the quantum system will be in the ground state, over 90%. Okay, so how small is small? How small are we going to need to measure in order to measure these effects? Well, we're going to need to measure something like fractions of proton diameter. The particular system that I'll be talking about, it turns out, even though we're going to be shooting for very, very small displacements, it turns out it gets harder if you go to bigger and bigger objects. So that zero-point motion, the amplitude of the quantum ground state, it's got a very simple solution that you'll probably all solve in your undergraduate quantum mechanics class. It looks like this. So zero-point motion is proportional to 1 over the square root of the mass and the frequency. And so if I go to very, very big objects, very, very large masses, for instance, like the Golden Gate Bridge with its 400 gigagram mass, which I calculated on Google, it has a zero-point motion that's about a 2,000th of a proton diameter. Okay, so that's not very useful. It's unlikely that I'll be able to measure something that small. And in particular, what I'd like to do is make that mass as small as possible and make the frequency as small as possible. And because that raises the size of zero-point motion. So in particular, for the systems that we'll be talking about today, we'll actually, because we can make the mass so small, these nanoscale systems, we can get this zero-point motion up to something like 10,000 proton diameters, which is a significant improvement over the Golden Gate Bridge. Okay, now how cold is cold? Well, of course, what I said is that the ground state temperature that we're going to need to reach is going to be something like this. So as we move to higher and higher frequencies, we can look at correspondingly warmer and warmer systems where we can still see quantum effects. But if you'll remember back to the previous slide, that's a constraint that's going in the opposite direction. So what I'd like to do is have very, very small frequencies, and that's essentially because the system will become less stiff and it will deviate further from the equilibrium position as I lower the frequency. But I'll also need to get that system colder. And so in general, what we'd like to do is get the frequency as high as we possibly can so that we can have the system very warm and we can measure just sort of conventional refrigeration methods as opposed to, say, dilution refrigerator. But if we do that and we don't drop the mass, then the spring constant will go up quadratically, and basically the system will exhibit vanishingly small displacements. And so this simultaneous constraint of needing a very high frequency to be able to probe the system at relatively warm temperatures and also a small mass, and then we can keep the zero-point motion large, is really what's driving a lot of the innovations in this field. Okay. Now, of course, that's what we're looking to be, to pose a property system to be, but how do you actually measure this quantum mechanical mechanics? Turns out the way you do it is, with light. So there's no accident that we're trying to track photons and photons. We want to use the photons to actually measure and manipulate the photons. And so the way this works is the canonical system is that, we're going to look to essentially make a system where we have an optical cavity where one of the mirrors can move. Okay, and that's sort of a canonical system. Obviously, my nanoscale oscillators look anything like this. But the basic physics is that I have a mass on a spring, and one of the masses, or both the masses, say, make some component of an optical cavity which changes when the oscillator moves, okay, when the mechanical oscillator moves. And I want to be able to map that somehow to some property of the optical system that I can measure. Okay, and the way this is going to work is actually pretty simple. So if I were to look at a mirror with, say, 90% transmission, or 90% reflectivity, so 10% of the light is transmitted, okay, and let's pretend that this material that I've made the mirror out of doesn't have any color preference at all. It's just 90% reflective over very, very large bandwidth. And of course, if I scan the frequency of my laser, as the laser changes colors, I don't really expect to measure anything interesting over there. As a function of frequency, the transmission is very flat, okay, it's by design. On the other hand, if I put two mirrors, well, the obvious thing is I should get 10% through the first and 10% through the second, and I should measure 1% of the light over on the photodiode. And so then as I scan the frequency, I see, over here, I get 1%, but it turns out that there's something sort of magical that happens. For a very particular frequency, all of a sudden, all the light goes through. Okay, no matter how reflective you make these mirrors, whether they're 90% or 99% or 99.99999%, okay, all of the light will be transmitted through these mirrors for a very particular frequency, and a lot of you will recognize that the frequency at which that happens is when the wavelength of the light will fit basically exactly 1/2 time across the cavity, and that means that that when it reflects off the mirror, that it will make a complete phase evolution back to 2 pi steradians, or back to 2 pi radians when it completes a ramp into the cavity, and so it will constructively interfere with itself only for that frequency. And that we call a resonant frequency. Okay? And at that frequency, basically, you get 100% transmission through this cavity. That's a simplistic view. It doesn't end up being 100%, but it's very, very high. Okay? That's actually easy to calculate that, just based on the things that I said before. I know that the wavelength must fit in two cavity lengths, or half the wavelength fit in cavity length. And then in terms of the angular frequency of the light, I can just calculate that pi c over l. Now, what happens if the mirrors move? Okay, so we know what happens if the mirrors are stationary and I scan the frequency. What happens if I fix the frequency and now move the mirrors? Well, I have this original length L0 that we had in the previous slide, and we know that the light will be resonant then. Okay, and then as a function of x, let's look and see what happens. Okay, so we expect that there'll be some resonant frequency of the cavity that's now a function of x, and we expect this thing to move. Okay, and when it gets to this point here, where the laser is actually resonant with the cavity, then we expect there to be large transmission, but small transmission otherwise. Okay, and that sort of will be imprinted here. Okay, and we expect the transmission to rise when the laser when the cavity passes through resonance for the laser. So it sort of looks like this. Okay, so we have the fixed laser frequency, and now the moving mirrors, they scan the resonant frequency over our laser probe. Okay, and so what it allows us to do is map the motion of the mirrors to something we can actually measure. Okay? I can measure the motion of mirrors if they're big and I'm moving them myself or something, but if I can't measure the motion directly, then it's useful to be able to map that motion to some variable of the optical system, which in this case we're going to use the transmitted power. Okay? And so we're going to be looking to sort of harness this effect. And of course, what we're most interested in is making the system very, very sensitive to motion. And to see how that is sort of optimized, what we'd like to do is take a look at this original resonant frequency here. Okay, and so now as a function of x, we're going to have a frequency that looks like this. And of course, if we take the derivative, then that should be somehow related to the sensitivity of the system. So if we call this derivative of the cavity frequency with respect to the position of the mechanical oscillator, or the position of the mirror x, then in this case, we can calculate it exactly. And it's just equal to omega 0 over L0. And this is a canonical system. It's sort of an archetypal system, but this result is true in general. If I want to have very, very large coupling between motion and the optical frequency of a cavity, then what I want is a really, really large frequency, and I want a really, really small length. Okay, so the length of the cavity I want to make very, very small. Okay, I want to squeeze the system down as tight as I can, and I want to make the frequency very, very big. And of course the frequency shift is going to be proportional to to my ability to make this derivative large for the system. Okay, and so again, I want this G to be very, very big, and that means I want big frequency, small length. Okay, so that's why we're going to basically use lasers, which have very, very large frequencies, something like 10 to 15 hertz, and we're going to use very, very small lengths. And that's sort of one of the things motivating the nanoscale implementation of these systems. Now, of course, we're talking about harmonic oscillators, so if we put this thing on springs, then now we have the masses of the mirrors composing part of the oscillator and the spring constants composing the other part, so we'll get some natural resonant frequency. And now we'll be able to map the state of the system and monitor the motion of the mechanical oscillator by watching some variable of some property of the system, optical system, like a transmission through the cavity. Okay. Now, what we're looking to do again is map this delta x, right, to a delta omega. So the motion of the mirrors causes a motion of the optical frequency. Okay, and we know that eventually what we'd like to see is some oscillation in the transmission over here. So we have some transfer function g, right, the omega dx that gets us there. We know how that one works. The question is, how do you get from delta omega to delta t? Okay, well, one way to make it more clear is actually to do a proper measurement. So if instead of probing at the top of the resonance, if we sit right here on the side, then you can see that sort of, what we're measuring here now I've got this sort of linear translation in the optical transmission as that's linear in delta x. Okay? And you can see that sort of what I'm doing is I'm measuring the slope of this curve. Okay? And so the question is, how do you make the slope of an optical cavity very, very steep? Well, it turns out that the way that you make the slope of a cavity very, very steep, because this is just showing what would happen if the cavity had a less steep line shape, and so now you measure smaller transmission oscillations. But the way that you make cavities very, very steep, it turns out, is you want to be able to store light for long periods of time. Okay, so this is a series of curves showing decaying oscillations as a function of some parameter we're going to call Q. And so this is the motion of a damped oscillator. And it turns out that the Fourier transform of this time signature, so if I have these decaying oscillations, the longer they live, right, this blue curve, which lives longer than the sort of pinkish magenta curves, right, turns out that the Fourier transform of the time signature, which is the frequency spectrum, will be very, very narrow. And the longer that I can store the light, the more narrow the transmission line shape of the cavity will be. Okay, and so what I want to do is I want to be able to make cavities that can store light for a long, long time. Okay, so I want high Q cavities. Okay, not low Q. Okay, and the ability to store light for a long, long time is essentially a measure of the optical loss of the system. So what I need to do is make very, very low loss optical systems that will have corresponding sharp, narrow line widths. And that will basically give me the maximum transduction between the frequency of the cavity and the transmission I can measure. Okay, so a very, very sharp line width will now transduce a very, very large change in transmission for the same fluctuation in frequency and the same fluctuation in position. Okay, so, and now, of course, I've been talking about these sort of canonical systems. How do we map this over to a system like this? Well, what we're going to do is essentially, use some monolithic piece of silicon. Okay, so silicon, it can basically trap light inside of it because it can be reflective. Okay, I can make it more reflective with messing that I'll talk about in a little bit. But I can basically make this silicon reflective, and it can look like, two mirrors, one mirror here, one mirror there. The light transmission is inside the silicon now, or the light stores inside the silicon. But this block of silicon can vibrate because it has, natural modes of oscillation. Okay, and so I can map this whole system, okay, back to the sort of canonical system that we've discussed so far. So I've got mirrors, I've got a mass of silicon, and I've got a spring, which is essentially, the internal bond strengths of the atoms, right? So, in particular, I've got the masses of the atoms, okay, and they'll compose the mass of the entire system, and the bond strengths between them, which will provide the stiffness of the system, okay. Now, of course, we don't really have to talk about like a molecular dynamics system, molecular dynamics simulation or anything to model this, because it turns out that in a nanometer cubed of material, there are 176 atoms. In 100 nanometers cubed, we have 176 million atoms. Okay, so even in 100 nanometer cubed volume, we still have plenty of atoms that we can use a continuum description of the system. Okay, and so all I'm going to do is basically use a continuum description of this block of silicon to describe the mechanical oscillations and the optical, of the optical property of the system as a cavity. Okay, and of course, there are ways to write down Hooke's law that in terms of the stress and strain of the material that will be equivalent to the harmonic oscillator on a spring kind of thing. But we don't need to worry too much about the details. But in particular, to summarize this sort of tutorial in quantum classical optical mechanics. So we talked about quantum mechanics and, sort of why we might want to learn a little bit about classical harmonic oscillators and quantum harmonic oscillators and then try to measure one. Okay? And what we learned from that is that in order to measure a quantum harmonic oscillator, we want a really high frequency and we want a really small mass. Those are the importance that are, sort of the properties that are important for the quantum mechanics. In order to measure it, okay, we know that we want a really high frequency. Again, we want a really small mass. And we want a really high Q, so we want to be able to store light for a long, long time. So now we sort of have all of the pieces of the puzzle that we need to go ahead and try to make one of these systems. And we weren't the only people trying to make these systems. There were a lot of people that tried to measure these kinds of effects. There was, in fact, some sort of a race where lots of different groups around the world were trying various things to try to measure the motion of the quantum mechanical oscillator in its ground state. In particular, there are sort of two systems that emerged as kind of the leaders of the pack. One was optical microcavities done originally in Perry Bahala's group at Caltech and then carried considerably further by Tobias Pickenberg at Max Planck Institute. And then the coplanar waveguide resonators that were being done by most probably, I think, probably Keith Schwab and the some people at Gila in Colorado. But the thing about these two systems is that while you can see that the push is towards very, very small mass and very, very high frequency, the difference between these two systems is that this one actually had a picogram scale mass, this one had a nanogram scale mass, but they were sort of given equivalent performances because this one was using an optical frequency to measure, so big frequency, and this one using sort of microwave resonators to measure. And so even though it had a smaller mass, they weren't able to beat out the optical systems because they just didn't have enough sensitivity since they were using such a low frequency electromagnetic mode. Okay, and so what we did basically was beat them all. Okay, and what the way we did it was by making something with sort of a femtogram scale mass and a gigahertz frequency mechanical mode. Okay, and so it would sort of fit underneath all of these on both scales. Okay, now how does this system actually work? Well, the way to think about it is that if I just have this beam, okay, and pretend there are no holes in it for a minute, well, if I hit the thing on the end with a hammer, I expect that there's going to be a sound wave that propagates along the length of the beam, right? And in addition, it sort of looks like an optical fiber, right? So I expect that there's going to be some guided optical mode where if I shine a laser on this side, I can propagate the light beam across the length of the beam. Now, the reason that the holes are there is essentially to take this waveguide and try to control the propagation properties of the light and the sound. Okay, so if you imagine this sort of waveguide propagating, this is the best picture I can sort of make with it sort of looks like it's vibrating, it's got some distortion there, it's also got light propagating down it. Okay, so this is sort of an example of a waveguide carrying light and sound inside of it. Okay, the frequencies, okay, of these modes that we'll try to be working with here are 2 gigahertz and 200 terahertz. Okay, 200 terahertz for the optics and 2 gigahertz for the mechanics. And those particular frequencies are no accident. Okay, the optical frequency we picked because those are the frequencies of our lasers and one of the frequencies that silicon will carry transparently. Okay, and then the 2 gigahertz comes from basically the ratio of the speed of sounds of the two materials. So if you look at the speed of sound, they're basically different by a part in 100,000. So the speed of light is 100,000 times larger than the speed of sound. Well, the optical frequency is 100,000 times larger than the speed of, or than the mechanical frequency. And that, so basically what we're doing is we're working with equivalent wavelength. So if you take the ratio of the frequency to the speed to the frequency, then you end up with the wavelength, and what you find is that for these pairs of frequencies and wavelengths, then you have two waves, one acoustic and one optical, that have exactly the same wavelength. Well, if they have the same wavelength, then you'd expect them to interact with this lattice in very similar ways, right? In particular, they'll look like a Bragg stack or a periodic system of reflectors to these waves when they have the same wavelength. So that's what's responsible for those two pairs of frequencies. Okay. And it turns out that we can basically make very, very frequency-selective, high-quality mirrors for both the light and the sound at these two particular frequencies by engineering the structure like this. And so sort of schematically, what we're going to be looking to do is put these very, very high reflectors on two sides of a region where we can have propagation. Okay, and the way that we allow it to propagate in the center is we actually sort of change the properties of the lattice a little bit, just a little bit. They only need to be changed very slightly. And so that allows propagation in the center, but these very, very, very high reflective mirrors that are very low loss sitting on the ends. And so what we're back to is basically this concept that I was showing in the beginning of, you know, two mirrors sitting on either side of an optical cavity. And now what I'm going to look to do is sort of, you know, trap some kind of a sound wave that will vibrate this cavity inside of here and make it look like, you know, it's sort of contorting and stretching the cavity, and that will couple the light to the sound. Okay. So again, we're gonna have two mirror regions on either side of this region I'll refer to as a defect region, which is really just a region where you can have propagation. So we're deforming the lattice somehow in the middle to allow propagation there. And of course, you know, again, ultimately what we're looking for is this optomechanical coupling, where we can couple the light to the mechanical vibrations of the system. Okay. Now, the way that this system works, okay, is essentially by constructive and destructive interference of multiple reflected waves. So if you're an optical photon trying to travel through this system, okay, what you see is, you know, if I'm getting guided down the center, say, I see this system of high index, low index, high index, low index, high index, low index, right? And every time I need a dielectric interface between the air and the silicon, I reflect some of my amplitude. And of course, when I did that here, I reflected again. So all of these reflections, if they want to go forward in the system, they all have to add up constructively. That's very hard to do. Okay, and in particular, what you can do is you can set up regions in frequency space where you can't have any propagation at all. Okay, and those are called band gaps. It's a sort of a fundamental property of physical systems that are periodic. It's what underlies most of the properties of semiconductors in the computers that we'll remember how to do this presentation. Okay. And so what we're able to do is engineer these periodic reflectors to control where we don't allow light propagation, and that's what makes a mirror. Okay? And so in particular, I can get back to this kind of system where I can control the frequencies that are allowed inside of the cavity by engineering the dispersion of the system. Okay? And I can make that silicon into a very, very highly reflective mirror. Okay? But it's frequency selective. Okay, so that's sort of the important point. So I can control this. I can make it a mirror, but I don't make it a mirror everywhere. It's not like a mirror I would look at in the mirror and see myself, right? It only reflects particular frequencies of light very strongly. Okay. But what happens is, you know, if I put this mirror over here and this mirror over here, and I allow some propagation in the middle by changing the properties of the system a little bit, then I'm going to localize some energy, just like I localize energy between these two mirrors when I do it in sort of bulk optics. And what that looks like is this. Okay, so it turns out that we don't just make square well potentials, you know, like you might do, you know, sort of very simple system. We actually make parabolic potentials for the light and the sound by sort of quadratically changing some parameter of the system. And so just like in quantum mechanics, when you have a parabolic potential, a quadratic or harmonic oscillator potential, you get these Hermite-Gauss modes along the direction of the potential. We got the same thing. So we have these Hermite-Gauss mode profiles for the envelopes. So we have the first order mode, the second order mode, the third order mode, okay? And the same thing happens in the mechanical modes, except the mechanical modes trap lots and lots and lots of different types of vibrations, but only some of them really interact with the light. Okay? So these are the sort of more interesting mechanical modes that we're going to trap inside of our system, the ones that interact very strongly with these optical modes. Okay, now, of course, when you're talking about motion, it's really nice to see what the motion actually looks like. So these are sort of what the mechanical modes look like that we actually get trapped. And we sort of give them very affectionate names like reading, recording, and pinch modes. But really what describes them better is their group symmetries and things like that that determine whether or not they can scatter light, and their wave functions which determine how strongly they scatter light. Of course, so the you know, things that are sort of really important in terms of the properties we talked about before are the frequencies of these oscillators. So where they, you know, what how fast they oscillate, and their mass. Now, when I say their mass, in this case, what we mean is effective mass. And so really what I do is if I add up all of the atoms in this system and multiply them by how much energy they have when they're oscillating, you know, how much kinetic energy they can attain, and then I divide through, normalize that integral, then I come up with some scaled mass that is that determines basically how much of the material actually goes into motion. Right? So over here, where the thing is barely moving at all, it doesn't really contribute any mass to this oscillator. So it doesn't really matter how long this bridge is. Really, in the end, the only thing that makes any difference is these sort of center five rungs. Okay? And then down here is a different kind of motion, but you can extract all the different properties of those modes too. You come up with something that will end up oscillating about 0.8 gigahertz with a mass of 50 femtograms, because there's just less material moving here. Of course, these are all from FEM simulations, finite element method simulations, and so this isn't exactly what you necessarily expect to see, except it turns out it basically is, but because the modeling is very good. But in general, what we're going to be looking to do is we're going to have this trapped optical node, okay, and then this is sort of a copy of this beam. So this thing, we're going to have this mechanical node. And sort of just like the analogy that we're trying to shoot for with these moving mirrors, what I really have is this material system that traps this optical node, and then the material system itself vibrates in a way that changes the properties of that cavity. So this looks very much like the light being trapped in between two mirrors, and the mirrors moving back and forth on a spring. And that's really the why the system is very powerful analogy, because not only does it sort of look like it, but you can map all the different parameters of this system to that mass on spring system that I talked about before. Okay, and of course, what we really want is to get dispersive coupling, and it turns out that so what is the length of the system? Well, that's actually sort of a more complicated question, but it turns out that through a electromagnetic perturbation theory, you can derive what is an effective length of the system, and it turns out that just like in the case of these masses on a spring, the smallest you can really make the system is sort of the equivalent of a half wavelength of the light. Okay, and it turns out that it's the same here. And so the best you can ever do is to make this sort of L effective, a half wavelength. And these particular systems, one of the advantages of them is that we have very, very tight control over both the mechanical and the optical wave functions. And so we're actually able to get these optomechanical coupling strengths up to the limit that diffraction for the light actually allows. Okay, so we can generate an optomechanical interaction that is physically as large as it can be for the photon and photon frequencies involved. Okay? Now, of course, every different optical mode couples to the optically active mechanical modes in a different way, so only some of them will be very, very strongly coupled, some of them will be more weakly coupled. And it's the wave functions that make the difference. Okay? So for this first system that we ever engineered, the best coupling we got was between this fundamental optical mode and the breathing mode down here. The breathing mode modulates the width of the cavity, which has a very strong dispersive effect. Turned out just for it to have all the best properties. 2.9 microns is about three times larger than the best you could basically do in the system, but eventually we're able to push it down there. But I talked a lot about sort of what the system does. I'll just spend a couple of minutes on how we actually make the system. So again, I said we start with a silicon on insulated microchip. I'm going to be showing two views of this SON microchip as we take it through its process flows. One of them is going to be basically from the top down. Oh, let me discuss the thicknesses first. the device layer, the layer of the suspended, the thickness of the suspended membrane would be this layer here, and it'll be about 200 nanometers. We'll have underneath it about 2,000 nanometers of glass, and then sitting on a very, very thick, which is not to scale, substrate, which is about half a millimeter thick. Okay, and again, we're going to be looking at two views as we take you through the process flow, one from the top and the other one from the side. Okay, so the top, oops, sorry. The view from the top will be shown here, and the view from the side, this is obviously the cross-section, so we'll show that there. Okay, so the first thing we do is we spin on what's called electron beam resist, which is basically a polymer, like fiberglass, that's suspended in a solid. And you can spin it on very, very flat, just as flat as the silicon underneath it. Okay, and this is very, very
spin
special.
On.
Spin, you literally you put a drop on and you spin it. And it, basically, the when you spin a fluid, you get a parabolic shape, and then the radius of curvature depends on the spin rate. And so if you spin it really, really fast, you get a very, very large radius of curvature parabola, which looks flat. Okay. And when you after you spin it on, it turns out that this particular polymer has been designed so that if you expose it to high energy electrons, it'll actually change the properties of the material such that, just like film, where I expose, I can put through some chemical process of amplification, and then that makes some very significant change in the properties. The significant change in the properties for this particular kind of resist is it goes away. So where I expose with electrons, I can basically make go away. And so from the top, to make this pattern here, just the beam part, I won't worry about the lattice around it, but what I want to make is I want to draw with electrons this big box and this big box and some little boxes here. Okay, and if I look from the cross section, now I've got these holes in the resist that I can see in the silicon. Okay, now there's a tool called an inductively coupled plasma reactive ion etcher. And it's a very complicated tool, but basically it makes a big old plasma, and it directs that plasma down against from top down against the surface. And these ions, which acquire a fairly large energy, they can both ablate the silicon underneath, and they also they can undergo chemical reactions and remove material. But basically, the point of this etcher is to basically transfer the pattern from the silicon, from the resist into the silicon. So basically, just drill holes wherever the resist was missing. Okay. And the reason that we call the resist resist is because it resists plasma etching. Okay, so its whole job was basically to resist this plasma etch and allow us to transfer the pattern into the silicon in a little tiny bit of the glass. Okay, it just barely touches the glass. The glass etches very, very slowly. But hydrofluoric, after we remove the resist, okay, so that now we can see the silicon on top, okay, and we can chemically clean it and leave no remnants of that resist. If we use hydrofluoric acid, then basically just dip the whole chip into a bath of hydrofluoric acid. Hydrofluoric acid will leak glass like gangbusters and not do a thing to silicon. And so what we can do is we can undercut this structure and leave just the suspended pattern that we drew with the electron beam. So basically you can make a pattern that you can draw. Make a CAD file and then transfer that pattern into the suspended membrane. And that's how we basically make these structures. How we measure it is also somewhat involved, I guess. For those of you that know about optical fibers, what an optical fiber basically consists of is a single optical fiber that can be used in telecommunications, has 125 micron cladding of glass, and then a higher index core in the middle that's about 10 microns. And if you were to basically heat the thing up and extrude the core, you would see something like this. So a 10 micron core inside of 125 micron cladding. It's normally guided by the index contrast divided between the glass, the high index glass and the low index glass. But if you pull it out into the air like this, then it'll be guided by the index contrast between the glass and the air. Okay. Now it turns out you can go way, way further. You can go down to basically like a half a micron diameter of the glass thread. So it looks like really like a spaghetti string of glass now. Much, much smaller, more like a hair of glass. Now the thing will still guide a single mode optical field. Okay, so it's still very, very good at data transmission and all that stuff. The problem is that it's exposed in the air. So the reason they don't use this for optical communications is because if a speck of dust lands on your fiber, then you don't get internet, right? So the thing about optical fibers is that the field is embedded inside of the glass, and it's very, very robust to damage and dirt getting on it, right? But we want to be able to access the field inside of an optical fiber, try to couple to our devices. And so we pull this thing very thick, very thin, by heating up the hydrogen torque until we just have this very, very thin thread of glass. And it turns out we can actually do it in a way that allows us to make a continuous transition from this single mode optical fiber like this and this single mode optical fiber like this. So we basically have one device that is tapered from big to small and back to big. And that allows us to put light into a regular optical fiber from a laser put it through this very thin section where we can get very close to an optical resonator, like that. And then it allows the evanescent field in this optical fiber to interact with the evanescent field of the resonator, and they can exchange energy, and we can extract that energy back, put it back into the fiber, measure it on a photodetector, and have a very nice, compact, alignment-free system for doing these sort of precision measurements. Okay, I'll sort of skip this slide, but basically all I'll say is that, the other thing that we do for these is we also sort of fold them into little U-shapes so that we can get them really close to the surface of the nanobeam. But basically, it's the same. And I won't talk too much about the coupling mechanism. The one thing that's probably worthwhile to say is that because we're not measuring, so in the Fabry Perot, most of the light is reflected unless you're on resonance, in which case it's transmitted. In this case, when you're not on resonance, the light just goes right through the fiber. It doesn't care about the cavity. And so you normally measure one for your transmission. When you're on resonance, the light goes into the cavity, and then the cavity loses the light. And so we're able to adjust the relative strength of the coupling between the taper and the beam, and the beam and the external world, such that all of the light is lost inside the beam on resonance. And so it just looks like a slightly different shape. It's inverted. So we get 100% transmission. Unless we're on resonance, we get no transmission. Okay. So, but it's basically, you know, it's just inverted. Functionally, it's the same. So now we fabricate our system, and we put our optical fiber next to it, and what do we measure? Well, so we can actually measure these three optical modes that are in our sort of laser band. Well, one at about 1480 nanometers, and the others up higher than that, about 40 nanometers each, a little bit larger this one. But and so we can measure all three of these modes by scanning our laser. We can measure the properties of the optical modes, their loss, that sort of thing, how strongly they're coupled to the fiber. Okay, but then if we zoom in, we sort of sit on the side of one of them. So if we sit on the side of this one, say, because this is the most deeply coupled, okay, then what we expect is that when the mechanical modes of the system are making the thing vibrate, that this optical mode should be moving back and forth just like our canonical system that we've been talking about. And so we expect to see some sort of modulation of the optical field that's the response of the system to these mechanical motions. Okay. And in fact, that's what we see. Okay, so when you actually do this experiment, the first thing you see are these very sort of low frequency modes down here. Turns out we can characterize every single one of these modes. Because what we're looking for are these localized modes, but in the end, this thing is a big old beam, and so the beam itself can bend and stretch and twist. And so we can see all those modes, and we can characterize them in terms of finite element method simulations, right? So when we have acoustic vibrations like that, this big peak right here is actually the fundamental acoustic, the second order acoustic mode of the larger beam, the global beam. Okay. And of course, then as you go to higher and higher frequencies, okay, the populations of the phonons are getting smaller and smaller and smaller, because it's just, you know, the system is getting stiffer as you go to higher frequencies. And then you can see something sort of awkward happens right around here. You get this huge spike in the amplitudes. Everything was sort of dropping off nice and smoothly, and then boom, you get this huge spike. Well, this is exactly the frequency where the wavelengths are getting small enough to interact with our lattice, and you get this localization of the energy inside of your Bragg cavity. Okay, and so down here, these are the pinch modes, this sort of lump of modes, and there's a lot of them, right? Remember what I said is that we make this parabolic pinchable of modes, so you end up with a ladder of states that all have different optical interaction strengths with a particular optical field you're measuring. Then down here, you have this really sort of weakly coupled accordion type mode, right at the frequency you predict with the FEM simulations. And then we have this group of breathing type modes down here at around 2 gigahertz. Okay, and so one of the more important features of this system is that we can measure the noise, obviously, the resolution with which we can measure this amplitude. And it turned out that for the first iteration of the system we ever made, we were able to get within a factor of 8 of zero-point motion. So our ability to resolve mechanical motion with this optical system was only a factor of 8 of the limit set by quantum mechanics, this zero-point motion of the mechanical system. Okay. So, the system has been optimized, and unfortunately, I'm actually getting pretty close to running out of time here. So the other thing that I'll just say sort of quickly is that in addition to being able to measure the motion, we're also able to change the motion, to manipulate the motion. And the effect that underlies this is best illustrated by, again, a mass on a spring, but imagine that the face of this mass is silver, so it makes a mirror. If I bounce photons off the end of this mass on a spring, then you can imagine that, when the spring is moving away, the photons that are reflected this way are being shifted to the red. Okay? And in return, they're exerting a force on the oscillator that's tending to speed it up. When the oscillator is moving towards the laser, the photons that are reflected are shifted to the blue. Okay? And as a result, there's a force on the oscillator that tends to slow it down. And so the spectrum of the scattered of the reflected light, I'll get red side bands and blue side bands that correspond to the laser photons shifted by the mechanical frequency. And I'll also have a corresponding force on the oscillator. But because I scattered equal populations to the red and the blue, okay, which is basically a property that, you know, the free space doesn't have a color, right? So the, you know, the air, well, in particular vacuum space, isn't colored. So it doesn't have a preferential scattering rate for red and blue photons of this small shift. Turns out if you really shift to large frequencies, then actually space is sort of colored. But at very, very small frequencies, like these mechanical frequencies, space has no color, and you get equal populations of red and blue photons. That means the forces speeding it up and the forces slowing it down are exactly the same. And over a single cycle of the mechanical oscillator, the average is zero. So there's no net energy extracted or imparted to the mechanical system. Okay. Now, contrast that with being in a cavity. If I sit on a cavity and I have my photons bouncing off the mirror, now the photons can't just scatter in free space, they have to scatter in my cavity mode. And the cavity mode is basically a representation of the density of optimal states that are available in the cavity. And so the scattering will be proportional to basically the amplitude of this cavity line shape. Okay? And so if I sit right on resonance for the optical mode of my laser, then of course my red and my blue photons, which are symmetrically spaced around the center, will have equal scattering rates. On the other hand, if I let the laser scan over this optical resonance, then at various places, okay, the red photons will be enhanced or the blue photons will be enhanced based on the relative scattering rates, you know, when they're separated by the mechanical frequency from the laser line width. Okay? And so, in particular, if I sit on this side, I can amplify the number of blue photons that are scattered relative to the red. Okay? And if I think about what's happening there, I'm scattering more blue photons than red photons. Well, that means that something must be creating that deficit of energy. Well, it turns out that the mechanical oscillator is giving it to you. So you're actually extracting photons from the mechanical system and creating photons with higher frequency, more of them than you are with lower frequency. And so you're actually extracting energy from the mechanical oscillator and it's being cooled. Okay. Now, it turns out, and again, I can't spend very much time on this, but this was actually the technique that we used to cool the system down into its quantum mechanical ground state. So we started with a system that was sitting in a helium refrigerator, so sitting at about 8 Kelvin or so. And then, not that the temperature of liquid helium is 8 Kelvin, that was just the best we were able to do. But they were able to optically cool all the way down to the ground state and actually measure the quantum properties of the system. Okay. In addition, if we sit on the other side of the optical line, then we're scattering more red photons than blue, and that means that somehow or another we're stealing energy. We are amplifying the mechanical motion. So if we sit on the other side of the optical resonance, then instead of cooling the mechanical oscillator, now we're amplifying the mechanical motion. And in particular, if I look as a function of optical power, and if I probe this mechanical resonance, so this is sort of a zoomed in picture of that RF spectrum that we saw a few slides ago that corresponded to mechanical motion. If I keep increasing the optical power and I sit on this side of the resonance, then eventually I can basically create so much gain from the mechanical oscillator, so much amplification of the motion, that the thing starts to oscillate. And in particular, just like a laser, which is, you know, basically there's an optical oscillator with feedback. Okay, we can make this mechanical oscillator start to self-oscillate. And it's sort of an impressive system. So for about 190 microwatts of drop power in the first iteration of the system, when we were dropping 190 microwatts, the thing gain narrows by about a factor of 2,000. So it goes from a Q of about 1,000 to a Q of about 2 million. Okay, so we get gain narrowing just like you would in the laser. And we end up with a coherence ratio, which really sort of gives you a measure of how coherent the waves are that you're creating, of 2 million. Okay, and it turns out to correspond to an emission of 10 to the 12 photons a second. Well, if we go back to the first Ruby laser ever invented, the first Ruby laser had a coherence ratio of about 2 million and was emitting on average about 10 to 12 photons a second. It was a pulse laser, but the average photon that's emitted from the cavity was 10 to 12, or 10 to 12 per second. Okay, so the question is, where do our photons go? Well, our photons go out of the substrate. Okay, so the dominant source of loss for us, or at least we can engineer the dominant source of loss, be out into the rest of the silicon device layer. Okay, and so just like in an optical cavity, where you add energy inside of the optical system and you have the feedback reinforced by the mirrors, and then the light that leaks out becomes your tool to probe the rest of the world, we now have a new system where we can let coherent waves of sound now escape into the rest of the world and use them as probes for coherent interactions inside of these microchips. Okay, so essentially what we have is a new tool to generate coherent phonons in the same way as you generate coherent photons in a laser, but now we can use them for other things. Now, just going to speed through the rest of the talk, but basically it turns out it's very easy to make just acoustic band gaps so that we can guide these sound waves around. If I don't care at all about the light, if I just want to engineer the sound properties, it's very, very simple. And I can basically make it so that the entire device is shielded, so that lattice of cross that you guys were seeing in the first slide, that was really there to keep the sound inside for longer and longer times, make sure no sound escapes. Okay. But the cooler thing is that if I think about surrounding this thing in this lattice that will keep the sound inside, if I poke little holes, now I have sort of the equivalent of an optical fiber, where I have a fiber coupled laser now, and I can guide out the sound in a single mode waveguide and use that to impinge in a very, very concentrated, coherent way on other mechanical systems, optical systems, or electronic systems inside of this chip. Okay, and of course, we're not confined to just one-dimensional beams. There are plenty of ways of engineering systems in two dimensions that will eventually allow you to generate things like optomechanical circuits, where I can basically at will create regions where sound and light are forced to interact and interconvert, and then guide those phonons and photons around in circuits and cause coherent interactions, linear and nonlinear, to your heart's delight. Okay. Sorry, I have to move so quickly through this. This was sort of an application that I was going to discuss a little bit in terms of doing nonlinear phononics that are sort of the equivalent of nonlinear photonics, right? So nonlinear optics, Bloombergen and others invent nonlinear optics shortly after the invention of the laser. Well, shortly after the invention of the sort of mechanical laser on this chip, we'd like to start to look at nonlinear mechanical interactions that can be generated inside of these systems to try to probe the underlying features of lattices and generate quantum effects, just in the same sort of approach that you would do, using nonlinear optics, nonlinear photonics, and laser. Okay, and so I'm happy to talk about these things offline with people, but I am going to go ahead and wrap up. The last thing I really just want to say is that sort of the holy grail of this field where I'd like to go is to sort of incorporate photons, phonons, and quantum dots. So quantum dots are highly nonlinear quantum systems. One of the things that may or may not be evident from all this is that this interaction between photons and phonons is not particularly nonlinear. Okay, and so to add a very, very nonlinear element to the system gives you a lot more control over quantum states. And so what I'd like to do is create piezoelectric systems where you have full control over the phonons, the photons, and they can all couple together mutually, the photons and the artificial atom through a polariton, the phonon and the artificial atom through the strain of the mechanical system that the dot lives in, and then of course the coupling between the phonons and the photons brought to you by optomechanics. And this system is equivalent to a system that Peter Zoller and some others analyzed back in the early 90s, where they were looking at ions trapped inside of the ion trap, obviously. And they showed that you could actually manipulate arbitrarily and create arbitrary clock states and exotic quantum states of the mechanical modes using these more complex interactions of the mutual coupling between the ions and the polaritons and the photon-phonon coupling. And so without going into too much detail about that, this sort of system would really allow you to do things like generate shorter cat states of phonons, etc., the kinds of holy grails of quantum physics that I think everybody's basically really interested in. So with that, I'll say thank you for staying so long and having me here, and thanks to the committee and everybody else. So.
free, so that doesn't get put on it, or?
So it turns out, yes and no. With very, very pure float zone SOI, it's mostly HVAC free, but it turns out that the presence of a single, what's called the presence of a single defect in the material, it turns out that the average number of defects in the volume of material that we typically use is one. So we have this sort of Poisson ratio with a mean of one, which means we get zero or one or two defects on average, and that totally determines the mechanical Q of each system. So you make 10,000 identical systems, and now we're beading, writing, and meshing, and all that stuff. Then you get 10,000 different quality factors that all depend on where the defects lie inside. So it is mostly defect-free, but it is totally dominated by the defects themselves. So the understanding, using these systems as tools to understand the underlying lattice defects and all that is actually sort of becoming a more active area of research as these things become more mature.
Other questions? Are there other materials that you could use? I mean, the graphene kind or?
Yeah. Less exotic materials like silicon nitride and other dielectrics oxide that are readily available in the semiconductor world we have used, and I just didn't bother talking about because I already went over. Materials like graphene, people are already looking at the optimal modes of graphene, and I'm sure that they're already looking for the optomechanical coupling between them. One problem with graphene, of course, is that it's hard to measure. It's hard. Whereas we have full control over the sort of topology of the mechanical and optical modes in this, they basically get whatever they get off on the Scotch tape and lay down. So as that matures, I'm sure that they're going to be going there, trying to make very, very high frequency modulators and that sort of thing. Yes, sir.
What would be your choice for the bond dot?
I don't know. The understanding the properties in terms of like the strain and the energy level couplings is probably what should be optimized. But then also you need an optical transparency window that allows for very, very high Q modes. I mean, there's a sort of a lot of parameters that would go into optimizing such a system. I would in particular like to use a piezoelectric system. And the sort of thing that I showed, along the left and right corners, I showed there being electrodes. The reason I showed those electrodes is because if you have a piezoelectric material, you can actually create and measure the photons directly, as opposed to these kinds of systems where it's only an indirect creation and detection scheme for the photons. So it makes it more symmetric if you use a piezoelectric system. So I don't know, maybe aluminum nitride, if you can dope it properly and create. But that's a question that's open for research. So thank you.
How much of the fabrication and everything do you do at Sandia, or is it you order it and they send it to you, or?
No, so we kind of operated like Bell Labs. I mean, everything I presented in here, I did myself, the fabrication, the modeling, the experiments. It's actually not very difficult processing. It's only one mask, basically. If you look at a standard CMOS process, it might be like 300 different steps or something. These are like four steps.
Can you do that here, or does it require special
facilities? Well, you guys have the facilities here, but what you don't have is an electron beam writer. And so synth is actually a better facility in that regard, because e-beam writing is sort of what allows you to draw the pictures in the first place. So optical lithography will work, but at the level of resolution of the nature of the mask for optical lithography, are like $50,000 a piece. So it's cheaper to see direct rights.
Well, any other questions? If not, let's thank you very much.